Very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you all to session number 27 of ICF Travel Series Break Free. And today is World Environment Day also, so it's a very timely coincidence that we are having our session today. And our guest for today is Gunjan Menon. She is an award-winning wildlife photographer, and her work has been featured on Discovery Channel, Disney Hotstar, National Geographic, BBC Earth, Animal Planet, and a lot of other OTT platforms. So over to you, Gunjan.
Thank you so much, Vivek. Hello, everyone. Welcome and happy World Environment Day to all of you. Thank you for joining in. And I want this to be an interactive platform, so feel free to just ask questions. You have like a raise hand column. Hi, Dheeraj. Raise hand emoji right there. You can just raise your hand anytime through the talk. And if you want to ask any questions, we can have a conversation. And otherwise, if you feel that you want to ask something that can be taken at the end of the session, then you can drop your questions in the chat box. Either way works. I'm happy to accommodate any conversations, even midway through. So I'll just start sharing my screen. And just to give you an idea about what we'll be doing today, today is just a very basic introduction about what I do, how I started, and why conservation filmmaking. So if any of you want any details or like want to get more into depth of what I do, how I do, then maybe we can plan like further sessions for that. This will just be like a nice introductory chat about the field of wildlife filmmaking, conservation filmmaking in general. I request you all to mute yourselves unless you have a question, just so that we can run smoothly through this. Hope you're all feeling good. Can you see the screen? All good? Okay, great. So, like Vivek sir mentioned, I'm a wildlife filmmaker, and my work has been broadcast on various channels, but I always wanted to work in the field of wildlife. And ever since I was a kid, I was very fascinated by wildlife filmmaking, and not just wildlife filmmaking, just the wilderness. I was 3 years old when my grandfather had gifted me a book which was on rainforests, and it had the most amazing illustrations about species that lived in the rainforest and some bizarre creatures that I'd never heard about, never seen. And I was fascinated by that book. I was obsessed. And I remember my parents telling me that every night I used to just sit with a book. And I knew what a bird of paradise was before I knew what Cinderella was. So that's to give you a perspective about how crazy I was about wildlife ever since I was a kid. And as I grew up, I started watching documentaries. Thankfully, I had that exposure through my parents, that they would talk to me about wildlife. My brother would come out with me on walks. I grew up in Delhi, so not a lot of wildlife around, but there were like urban wildlife that I used to come across, like squirrels and bats. I remember I was in ninth grade when I rescued my first bat, and that was fascinating in itself, because all family members, and I'm a first generation a wildlife filmmaker, by anyone who's into anything remotely related to wildlife. So it's, mind you, it wasn't very, my parents weren't used to all of this. Like one day I randomly brought a bat home, and people usually say that, you know, this is what is happening. So that's how it all began. And I remember them being very supportive. But and then we eventually gave the bat to a rescue center. So some children were throwing stones at it, pelting stones, and it was hurt. So my brother and I just like rescued it and took it home, and then later found out what to do with it. But basically, to give you an idea about how I was crazy right from the beginning. And this is a photo of me and my assistant Buffalo recording an interview in a remote village in Nepal. Yeah, that's a more recent photo of the bat and a harial that we rescued. So I also mentioned that I traveled a lot, but it all started with filming what was in my backyard. I used to go to parks, started taking photographs of what was in my backyard, started going to zoos because that's the closest to wildlife that you can get in Delhi. So I used to take a lot of photos there, and that's how I started. Then eventually went all around the world. The first photo was taken in Nepal when I was filming red pandas. Under that was in India, in Dudhwa National Park, and we were filming something for the bird festival for the forest department. This owl was an educational ambassador in Scotland, and to the right of that is we filming some red deer in Bristol, and under that we were filming that was when we were filming turtles in Belas near Maharashtra, village near Pune. But the real break when I started full-time pursuing this career was after I got a chance to make the film The Firefox Guardian. I was pursuing my master's in wildlife filmmaking in Bristol, and we were supposed to make a 10-minute short film, and I was thinking, what should I make this film about? And that time red pandas were my favorite animals, and I'd read a article that said that there could be fewer than 2500 red pandas left in the wild, and that was very shocking because these were creatures that were magnificent and so rare, and yet we weren't able to know enough about them. There was hardly any awareness. When I spoke to my friends about this, one of them actually said, oh, I didn't know pandas came in red. So that took me by surprise that, okay, how was I going to push for conservation or tell people how to protect animals that they don't even know about? So that's when I realized that to effectively tell stories about wildlife, you need to make sure that people understand what the story is. People can empathize. So then I started looking for a story that could help me tell the story of red pandas, but also, you know, make people relate to it. So then I saw this article. It was called The Changing Role of Women in Conservation. And there was this photograph where this woman was standing right in the center, surrounded by all these forest guards. And there was a line that she said that I'll do anything for red pandas. And her name is Menuka. She was the first female forest guard working in Nepal with Red Panda Network to protect red pandas in her community forests. So I was instantly drawn to her, and I started writing to Red Panda Network, telling them that, hey, I want to make a film on red pandas, and I'm really inspired by this woman. Can I focus on her? So they got back saying, yes, we can absolutely go ahead with it. And we made the film. This is a small intro from the film of what her life is like.
For one of them, it's been a long road to become a guardian.
Meru naam Menuka Bhattayo. Ra mero ghar wari pari jangal cha ra bhir pakha ghar najikai euta khola cha. मैले 6 वर्षको हुँदादेखि मैले जङ्गल प्रवेश गरेको त्यो बेला मलाई जङ्गल जाँदा त्यस्तो चराचुरुङ्गी कराएको नि ठिक लाग्यो र अरू यसो मसिनो बोट बिरुवाहरू देख्दाखेरि सानो सानो थियो र यो हुर्केर कत्रो ठुलो हुन्छ कि यत्रै बस्छ होला लाग्थ्यो त्यतिखेर रिपन्डा नेटवर्कको महिला फरेस्ट गार्जन हो र यो मेरो कथा हो।
You all could hear that as well, right? Yeah, okay, great. So that was her intro in the film, and she was really inspiring and making a film before. I had never imagined that it would be such hard work, and there were a lot of blood. There was blood literally, because we used to wake up in pools of our own blood, because leeches were, you know, feasted upon our ankles all night, and we trekked for 4 to 5 hours every single day in 12,000 feet up in the Himalayas, and this terrain was really, really unforgiving. And tears, because I kept getting hurt. I remember that once, I have to apologize because it just started raining, so there might be like some network ups and downs. So yeah, I was saying that I broke my ankle once because we were trekking in such difficult terrain, and the porters there had to like carry me because we were just struggling. We were just stuck in the middle of nowhere. So all of that, but it was totally worth it. And here's a glimpse of all the crazy behind the scenes that used to happen.
No
problem. This is after 5 minutes of walking.
Shut up. Like, it's after 3 hours of walking.
How long has it been?
3 hours.
यो चिया चाहिँ रेड पान्डाको लागि हाल है यस्तै हो नि भाउजी, हामीले चाहेको आज होइन
So sign language, actually, because we didn't speak the same language. So the main protagonist of my film only spoke Nepali, and I only understood Hindi and English. So we had to use a communicator to understand each other. But I think somehow through the mutual love for red pandas, we just bonded, and we were able to communicate, and she was able to share some really personal feelings and share the hardships that she's gone through. But and that comes out beautifully in the film. If you've actually seen the film, or I can share a link with you later, you'll understand what I'm talking about. And that coming out through this whole language barrier was also very special. And all that is worth it, because when I finally saw a red panda, that was one of the most beautiful things beautiful creatures I've ever seen. And I'll just let the shot do the talking. 1 second.
Thank you.
Miruka believes this is the cub from the nest. It's a huge relief for the team and will ensure the cub's safety from poachers.
मान्छेलाई रित्पन्न मार्ने अधिकार छैन. सबैभन्दा उनीहरूलाई चाहिँ जनचेतनाको कमीको कारणले गर्दाखेरि मार्छ र यसको महत्त्व नबुझेर मार्न सक्छ.
Finding this cub is another success for the Firefox Guardians, giving Menuka hope that what she has fought to achieve is still helping to secure the future of her Firefoxes.
किनभने रेड पान्डाको धेरै महत्त्व छ र यो गाउँ समाजले नजोगाएमा अरू कसले जोगाउन सक्छ र हामीले नै जोगाउनु पर्छ.
The first shot that you see of the panda just lifting his head up and looking, that's exactly what we saw as well. And I was just completely mesmerized. I forgot that I had to shoot. I was there for a purpose. I was totally mesmerized by how beautiful that red panda was. And I think that translated well the way we've actually introduced the red panda here. And this film was important on multiple fronts because it was not just a story about a creature, but it also had like a tangible impact on ground, and it increased the number of female forest guardians that Red Panda Network started employing, because they realized and through like a lot of, they had been working towards increasing the number of females, but then they realized how important females are to that ecosystem and how women have always been on the forefront of conservation. And that really helped encourage more women to step up and do such jobs, because earlier in their areas, local communities, their women are not expected to work outdoors. But I think this sort of encouraged them that it was okay, because they're seeing like a role model in Menuka. And through all the screenings that we've had worldwide of the film, we've continuously raised funds for Red Panda Network that puts it back into conservation in Nepal. And through that, they've worked on increasing the habitat of red pandas, restoring habitat. And right now, what happens is like the habitat is very fragmented in the eastern Himalayas. So they're working on restoring it, restoring the habitat. They're also working on expanding to western Nepal. Right now, this in the film we shot in eastern Nepal. And they're doing some incredible work. This film helps us. It's not a traditional NGO documentary. It's still shot like a film. So it helps people still see the great work that is being done in conservation and put money back into conservation. And it created a new role model. This is a photograph of Emmy, who lives in Oregon. And her father wrote to us saying that she loves the film and she's seen it about 12 times, and he gifted her a photograph of Menaka on Christmas, and her father snapped a photograph of her holding this photograph, and they sent it to Menaka in Nepal. And she was so motivated seeing that a girl who lives across seas is motivated by something that she's doing. So there also, like, if a 6-year-old, and then she said that she wants to grow up and become a conservationist. So that way it's motivating kids also to take up unconventional professions. So we took the same model, that a film can be more than just a film and actually have an impact. And then started using that for other projects as well. So this was a film I did along with the Gaia people. And this was an educational film made from a commercial film. So, sorry, we had worked on a project called On the Brink, and that focused on 8 different species across India. And one of the episodes was in king cobras. Now, with king cobras, what happens in the Eastern Ghats is they are killed at sites because of the sheer size. They're the longest venomous snakes. So these are huge snakes, and people really fear them. In India, like 50,000 people die of snake bites. But the truth is that king cobras do not attack when they're not provoked. So this was something that had to be conveyed to the people there. So we took a story. So in Agum Bay in the Western Ghats, there's a small village that coexists peacefully with king cobras. So we shot a film there and showing how people coexist with king cobras, and took it to the people in Eastern Ghats and showed them that people like you are coexisting with king cobras and calling a rescuer instead of, you know, killing them at sight. And dubbed it in local languages everywhere where human king cobra conflict was present. So this also worked really well because a few months ago we got an email saying that the people had started, in fact, calling rescuers instead of killing king cobras at sight. So my point is that film is such a powerful medium that you can tell a story and actually use that for conservation. This is just a small glimpse into the film. This is available on YouTube on Madras Crocodile Bank Trust YouTube channel. You can watch it whenever you want.
ಬಹಳ ಹಿಂದೆ ಕಳಿಂಗ ಒಂದಿಗೆ ಬದುಕಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹಳ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತಿತ್ತು. ಯಾಕಪ್ಪ ಅಂದರೆ ಆ ಹಾವನ್ನ ನಾವು ನೋಡಲೇಬಾರ್ದು. ಆ ಹಾವು ಮನೆಗೆ ಬಂದರೆ ಬಹಳ ಕೆಟ್ಟದ್ದು, ಆ ಹಾವು ಮನೆಗೆ ಬಂದರೆ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿದ್ದವರಿಗೆಲ್ಲ ಬಹಳ ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಬಹಳ ಭಯ ಇತ್ತು. ಸಣ್ಣಲಿಂದನೂ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಕಾಳಿಂಗ ಬಂದರೆ ತುಂಬ ಭಯನೇ.
We are in Agum Bay, a small village in Karnataka known for its diverse rainforests and the species that thrive in it. But the one species that stands out is the formidable king cobra, the longest venomous snake on the planet. There was a time when little was known about the king cobra. As such, legends and myths got attached to its name, making people across the country fear it. But rarely has a king cobra bitten a human. And there are reasons for this. The king cobra is said to be far more intelligent, active, and alert than any other snake on earth. They have a remarkable eye.
And one pitch.
welcome new beginnings.
And yeah, so people in Agombe
killed more than 350 king cobras from households in and around Agombe. Its work is responsible for transforming the mindset of the local community to no longer kill but leave snakes alone and call experts for help if needed.
ನನಗೆ ಹಾವಂದ್ರೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಭಯ ಇತ್ತು ಆದ್ರೆ ಅಜಯ್ ಅಣ್ಣ ಅವ್ರು ಇವಾಗ ಕೇಳಿದ್ರಿಂದ ನನಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹಾವು ಕಚ್ಚಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು ಬರೀ ನಾಕ್ ತರ ಹಾವು ಕಟ್ತವೆ ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾವೇನಾರು ಕಾಟ ಕೊಟ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ಅವು ಕಟ್ತವೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಕೂಡ ನಾ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡೆ.
Find out how a film can make an impact. I started thinking backwards. I started thinking of what impact. Sorry, someone's mic is on. If you can switch that off, that's causing a little disturbance. Thank you. So yeah, I started thinking backwards of how what is the impact or what is it that I want to achieve from the stories that I want to tell, and then started thinking backwards. So for a recent National Geographic project that I received a National Geographic grant for this project. I thought of what change I would like. So this is a critically endangered species of freshwater turtle, and they had been declared extinct in the wild. And we wanted to show that they exist in the wild, and that their conservation policies need to be strengthened. So for that, we went on an expedition in Assam to prove that they exist in the wild, which we were able to. The film is still not out, but that is like a feature length film we're working on, and we were able to film them in the wild. We were able to show that they're thriving currently, and that if they need all the protection that they can get, because these are some really unique turtles that are very important to the ecology of the whole Brahmaputra River. And the temples there, so these turtles are revered in Assam and they're worshipped. So in temple ponds, they're found and worshipped in, but they're found in really bad conditions. So maybe through the film, we will be able to push for better conservation strategy for these turtles. And that is the thought that I pitched the initial idea with. And I think that is what I do with every story that I think of now, of what is it that I can help with. And then I try and think of what story will help achieve this impact. And why I became a conservation filmmaker is because I grew up with the watching stories of wildlife. I grew up getting really inspired to tell wildlife stories, but I always grew up in a bubble. I saw all fluffy animals and beautiful landscapes, and I did not know how fragile our ecosystems were. But as I grew up, it came to me as a shock that those fluffy polar bears were not all that happy. The ice caps were melting, and the reality was quite different from what was seen in the documentaries. So I wanted to be the kind of filmmaker that would also tell truthful stories that can help people fall in love with wildlife. Not conservation stories don't always mean that they have to be very depressing or doom and gloom, and they can also inspire people to fall in love but also act. Just passively sitting and loving, I feel, is not going to help anymore, because we really need to inspire people to take an action. And for instance, and films are really, really powerful. I believe that they can really do this. For instance, in UK, when Blue Planet 2 came out, that show inspired people to push for a ban on single-use plastics. And that happened all across the country just because of one film. And even in India, there's this film that I really like. It's called Shores of Silence, and it's by Mike Pandey. And that film was instrumental in getting the hunting of whale sharks banned. So films can really drive change. We just need to know how to keep pushing, and how to, you know, not just stop at releasing a film. And for that reason, I recently started an organization along with my husband. It's called Beyond Premieres. And we help filmmakers like us create tangible change with their films, tangible impact with their films. Because why stop at just releasing a film when you can actually help with conservation on ground? And I wanted to keep it short in case we had more questions. So we can open the floor for questions now. But if there's anything that you would like me to cover or anything else that you have in mind, you can always write to me or get in touch with me on my email or through my Instagram. I'm very active on Instagram usually. So yes, you can ask questions now.
Thanks, Gunjan. Very interesting presentation. Over to the audience now for their queries. I think at the start, Dheeraj had raised his hand. So, Dheeraj, you wanted to ask something? Mr. Selvarajan, he is an ex-presenter for our series and he is a birder, so maybe we can have his comments.
Hello. Yeah. Good evening, Mr. Vivek. So nice. Again, you have given me a chance to talk about wildlife in this series. That's good, really. And of course, kudos to Gunjan. It was fantastic indeed. I see in you a very promising photographer, wildlife photographer. In fact, lifelong I have been thinking of becoming a wildlife photographer and all, but without a professional qualification and all those things. But I do photography, bird photography as well as wildlife, but wildlife not much. Well, I'm going to relocate to Bangalore from Delhi. So I think I would be having better chances there. Yeah. To go for wildlife photography. But of course, what would you suggest? Today is a very important day, Environment Day. You know, being an activist in my NGO Green Circle in environment, today I'm really happy to have a good presentation here from Gunjan. You know that the wildlife species like this panda, red panda and other things, you know, rare species are there which have to be conserved, and of course for that this time United Nations Environment Program has given a very good title, that is the word ecosystem restoration is the theme this year, and it's going to continue for the next 10 years. And of course this is going to be a very big challenge, because not only the world is facing the pandemic, you know, the environment is being in trouble now, but in India it's rather to a greater extent we are all seeing that environment is under disturbance. Yes, state sponsored disturbance, I would like to say, because in many cases I have been seeing that, you know, we are presenting we are making it possible, the government is making it possible to intrude into the jungle areas, wildlife areas and all. I do not know how we are going to meet this challenge when the policy makers are not knowing that this is going to affect our ecosystem. Today I have seen a WhatsApp message that only around 35-40 trees per capita in India are there. That means our jungles are less. But in my opinion, this statistical tool that per capita tree presence is not good for our country, because our country is thickly populated. But the only thing is that whatever we are already having, that forest area has to be protected. I don't know how far our Wildlife Act and the Environmental Act is going to help us in this way. Your presentation, Gunjan, it's really an eye-opener for us, because the way you have taken the photo, videograph is really good. I don't have any comment to say, because you are very, You have given me a small chance to see that, I mean, a piece of your entire this thing. I will see now in your other, I mean, videos and films. Let me go through it. Really, it's very nice, I would like to say. That's great. Please suggest me what kind of cameras can be used for videography as an amateur, not as a professional like you.
Sir, I believe that if you are really interested, you can shoot amazing films with your phone also. I've shot some really nice films with my phone. It's just the story at the center of everything. And but for birds, I think it'll be tricky. So you will need some long lenses. So you will have...
I have 600 mm is that with me.
Yeah, so... So that's good, sir. So if you want to start moving into film from photography, you can start thinking of your subjects as your characters, as heroes, and find like a little story that you want to tell around them. And like I said, everything you need is in your backyard. You just need, and I'm pretty sure you're observing them already. And they
started 40 years back.
Exactly. So many little stories playing out already. And just one shot, instead of one shot, you just need to shoot like a couple of shots to make a sequence, and there you'll have your story. You can start telling those stories already. Yeah. People have to learn from your years of experience and observing these birds.
Of course, extensively I have trekked in Western Ghats, and you know, well versed to Western Ghats, top sleeps, Parambikulam, Aliyar. These areas were my favorite areas, where I was knowing nook and corner of the places, and Kodaikanal, all those areas. Now again, I'll be exploring all those things again now.
Lovely. And also, can you add to, sorry, what you were saying, we face this problem that we are facing right now is because in India, the policymakers have a very species-centric conservation plan, if any. Anyway, the conservation plan is not a priority, but when they do, it's very species centric. And it's very simple, and it's proven that once you preserve the habitat properly, the species will thrive. But we don't want to look at habitat. We want to keep destroying the habitat, but we want the tigers to survive. We want our species to survive. So that's not going to happen. So I think once this gets deeply rooted, that you protect the habitat, the species will thrive. We can find a way to, you know, start protecting what we already have. Our ecosystem is already very fragile, and unless we do something now, and it has to come from the government side. Now, individual efforts, we can only raise our voice and pressurize them, but ultimately, at the scale that the destruction has already happened, it will have to come from the policymakers.
It's regularly happening. I do not know where it's going to end. It's regularly happening, you know, in the infrastructure projects, you know, road projects and other projects, you know, completely the wonderful, you know, pristine areas are being disturbed now. Mm-hmm. In fact, I'm having an NGO where I'm just having contact with almost everybody from Kanyakumari to Kashmir. Many people are in my network, and everywhere, Nagpur, you take it, Pune, everywhere there is some kind of disruption is going on. So this is one thing, you know, you are a conservationist, also a photographer, wildlife photographer, means you are conserving, definitely. You are documenting everything. That's a great thing for the posterity. You know, in my younger days, 40 years back, I was not having that much expertise. Though I used to go inside the Western Ghats Chola Forest. Chola Forest is one of the finest forests. You know, you will be getting scorpions of 1 foot. That big scorpions you can see there. So when I used to go there, I was handicapped that I don't have, you know, camera or video. I could not take in those days. We cannot afford us. We could not in those days. So now I'm regretting. But still some efforts we must make. All of us must make. Can you please tell me where you are exactly located?
I am in Pune right now.
Okay, Pune. Good, great.
One thing that is important to understand is that there is all kinds of commitment from all kinds of NGOs, as well as government bodies, to preserve the habitat. Okay? It is there. Those companies and those those groups of people and those departments are there, and they are themselves in combat with the other departments which are talking development, development, development. So we have a highway going through Tadoba. Okay, now Tadoba is an exciting place because there is no way you will not see a tiger. But I didn't go there to see a tiger. I had other work there. But the fact is this, that wherever there is, for example, our red panda also. The red panda is a very, very interesting species because it is very peculiar to this part of South Asia. And because it is part of South Asia, well, we think, okay, it will be there in Sumatra, so we don't have to bother. As if somebody else is going to save our family. Exactly. Not understanding that family is our own. Okay, I have experience in filmmaking, which is documentaries. I have experience in tourism because my father started the Department of Tourism. And I have been part of the World Wildlife Fund as the organizer for North India. So what you're talking to me today is really a complete feeling for me, because I'm of course interested in photography. It is an important part of bringing the world to the rest of the world. But I'm sure you would like to say, and you must have said in your program, I'm sorry, I was slightly inattentive. It is the Adivasi, it is the people of the soil that know everything about conservation. Exactly. And what to eat and where to eat and how to allow an animal or a species to thrive, and they live happily with them. There isn't any human species conflict when you're talking about the tribals, you know, people who live there. It is always because people from the city go and they want to intervene, or it is because a road has been built. So the basti has to go and move into the area where the animals were thriving. Now, this is the absolute biggest problem we have, and there is no end to the amount of effort we have to make to wake up the lawmakers and the people in power to understand that if we don't take care of the planet, we're not going to be anywhere. And there's
And we have to include these local communities in the conservation plans and not just sit in our cities and our air-conditioned rooms and make plans for them.
Because they know more than us. They're the ones who know it. They're the ones who know where the nest is. They're not knowing that it will take 45 days for the pigeons to bring you two. And then the father will sit in the night and the mother will go in the daytime. And you know, they will take turns. And I have seen the whole process in a balcony in Sarita Vihar in New Delhi. I mean, just because it was exciting to me, rock pigeon. Oh, a rock dove. And do this, because this is part of our living. But not everybody is concerned about this. Most people are interested in a BMW car or a Swarovski diamond or some other stuff that perhaps I'm lucky to have already gone through. I'm not in that space today. And it is not that only Indian people are insensitive to the environment. It is all over the world. So we need to really say that, look, we have people, the Maoris, for example, in New Zealand, they have beautiful stories about how a mountain fell in love with something and it had to move, it couldn't move, and how something helped it move. And I have this idea that we can write a book with a Maori story on one side and an Indian folk tale on the other, probably from the Adivasi groups, because they have the most wonderful stories. And they have the stories about conservation.
They're the original conservationists.
At the moment, I'm in a little bit of a high where I'm doing many, many things. But the fact is that we have more to learn from whom we think are illiterate. Anybody else.
Thanks, Kanish. Gunjan, we have two queries in the chat box, if you can read them.
Okay. So Deepthi asks, are you able to find platforms to showcase your work and create the kind of awareness for change that you aspire to? So that's a great question, Deepthi. Usually, we only look at television channels as ways to broadcast our films, but recently it's been changing a lot. A lot of our audience is on digital platforms, and we did a 7-part digital series for Round Glass Sustain. Now, if you haven't looked them up, you should definitely look them up. They tell beautiful short stories related to the environment, related to wildlife, and written and video stories both. And I think it's one of a kind in India where they focus on conservation stories, and the kind of freedom that we got while telling these stories was really inspiring, because we went to Kumbhalgarh Wildlife Sanctuary, which is a lesser known wildlife sanctuary in India. It's in Rajasthan, and we told stories of how raikas there coexist with leopards, and it's a matter of coexistence and compromise, but still, like, leopards on the fringes are able to thrive because of the relationship that they have with raikas. And there was several other stories about the habitat, about the lesser known species there, about this wonderful group of minarets that live near Udaipur, and they protect, they're for protection to migratory birds in their village. And so little stories like these, 3-minute, 4-minute stories, and they commissioned a seven-part series, and it's coming out right now. So 5 of them have already come out. There are 2 more left. So you can check out Round Glass Sustain. And apart from that, whenever I think of ideas, I pitch them to channels, I pitch them to digital platforms. Nature in Focus does a lot of such stuff. So there are options that are coming up now. Or otherwise, if I find that a story is too compelling, I just put it out anyway. So people just watch it. And if there's not a lot of cost involved, then I'm not looking for any financial gains anyway. I just want to create awareness. So those 3 things just work hand in hand, and we're able to survive as even conservation filmmakers.
Is crowdfunding a possibility?
Yes, ma'am. So my first film, Firefox Guardian, I crowdfunded for it. I raised about $4,500 for it, and just through crowdfunding, just by telling people this is the story I want to tell, just help me, and that was very successful. But I feel that works more for first-time filmmakers, or like when you're still a student. At this stage, I would feel uncomfortable just asking people for money to tell stories, because I feel that I would have. Now I look for sponsors or funders or, you know, commissioners instead. But I think if someone's starting out, crowdfunding sites like Indiegogo, or there are several Indian ones as well, these are definitely a very good option.
Okay, there is a gentleman in Pune. He's actually a surgeon, but he's very, very big person in photography also. If I get your contact, I will send you his contact.
Sure, ma'am. I will.
Gentlemen, I don't remember his name. It's something like Eric. And Eric. He's a very exciting person. He okay. came to Bhopal for the literature festival.
Oh, lovely. I would love to meet him. I will put my email address in the chat box.
Yes, please do that. I'll connect you. It's Thank exciting you. Because he's wise and he's well connected.
I would love to meet him. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Sorry, there are more questions. Sayantan Jiyath, how do you plan out the story? Are these not pre-written stories, but they develop on the spot along the way? How do you plan to shoot? How do you decide with the story and the script? That's a really nice question again, because people think that wildlife or documentary filmmaking does not need a script, but we always go on feel with the script. We go with what we call like an ambitious shopping list of script. We think of all the sequences that we would want, and a lot of research goes into the story even before you're in the field. So predicting possibilities of behavior will depend on your research. So you will, we tend to know exactly what to expect. Of course, animals will not follow your script and do what they want to. And then you improvise and come back to the edit desk and change the story. But when we are going, we have like a pre-production script, definitely. And we plan like, okay, we want a shot of all these key behavior sequences to tell the story. And once we come back, we look at all the footage and construct the story again. But definitely, yes, there's like a pre-production story as well. And how do I, what is the story? That is like a whole process. We need another 1 hour for that. But usually it just depends on, like I said, I think of the impact I want to get and then think of the story. I read a lot and I come across stories, whatever fascinates me, I try and think of how to make this interesting for the masses, because conservation stories told traditionally do not interest people anymore. They have to be packaged in an interest.
Life stages due to me alarm and Tom Halka because it is the wrong form of
understanding. I will share links, yes. Okay, Aditya asked if I faced any challenges as a female filmmaker. So initially, there weren't a lot of female role models when I was starting out. There weren't even enough wildlife filmmakers when I was starting out. But I decided I'll just learn filmmaking and I will combine wildlife on my own and just merge my two passions. Nowadays there are a lot of females in the industry, and it is I'd say that there are a lot of us here to support the younger ones who are coming in, so it's no longer like very challenging. And the challenges come when you have like unrealistic expectations out of yourself, like if you feel that women have to carry as much as men are on the field, if we have to, you know, brave it out to prove that we are as good. We are filmmakers, we are storytellers, there is no competition. We can just you know, tell the stories we want to without having to prove to anyone that we are capable of being in the field. So I feel it's fine. The challenges that I faced as a woman are not important anymore here, because I've grown past them. I've realized that others coming in will not face the same challenges anymore. So it's fine. I hope that answers your question. But to sum it up, we are here for you. If you have any problems, we will guide you through it.
Thank you so much.
Have I considered selling some of my stills or video footage? Okay. Sometimes when videos or your stock footage is not a part of a big program that needs to be sold, you can sell it on stock footage sites. There's a website called Black Box, which you have to be a member. It's a free website, and that will sell your footage to various stock websites all together, and that works on like a monthly payment process, and you can put all your extra stock footage on that, and that's very useful. There's also naturestockfootage.com, where nature related footage you can sell, and you know, earn a little extra monthly on the side with all your extra footage. So we do that on the side sometimes. Okay, Nija says that in a densely populated country like ours, can wild animals and people coexist, or are we heading for inevitable confrontation? Plus the growth agenda of countries, how does this all fit in the field of conservation? That's again a very vast topic, but from what we were just discussing, these local communities have been traditionally coexisting with wildlife since centuries, and it is possible as long as we respect the boundaries that nature has created. If we look at the current pandemic also, it has in a way happened because we did not respect the boundaries of nature. So coexistence is possible if we learn from the traditional local communities of how they function and how to respect the animal, then it's completely possible. And there are so many stories. I will send you links if you want. There's some beautiful stories of coexistence all around the country.
I'm so happy. I found the visiting card. I found him on Google also. And I will send him a message. And he is a dear, dear person.
Oh, lovely. Thank you so much.
Unbelievably interesting. And this is because there was a literature festival in Bhopal and he came to attend that. And since I'm a local, I'm a chatterbox. I talk to everybody.
How lovely. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Not at all.
Okay, Paushali has an interesting question. Mm-hmm. How to find conservation stories or how to find inspiring stories and work on them? How to build networking? So these are two different questions, Paushali. Do you mean how to find stories or do you mean how to build the network to tell those stories? Is she still here? Yeah. How to find the stories? Okay. So to find the stories, I think you have to read a lot and you have to know what makes a good story, what makes a good character. So a general rule, I mean, of course, there are many other ways, but a general rule I follow is to see where you can find a hero and what is that the hero wants to achieve, how is that hero achieving it, and what does he do to find like that end goal. And once, and that hero can be anything. It can be an animal character, it can be a local conservationist, it could be a forest guard. So for example, my hero recently in a film of mine was a forest guard in Kumbhalgarh. What does he do? What is his goal? He wants to be a photographer and conservationist. And what does he realize? He realized that leopards in his, like hyenas and leopards in his forest were decreasing. What does he do? He spoke to a few people around in the fringes of the village spoke to them about how they can help preserve the community. So basically your hero, hero's goal, hero's action, and turn that into a story. It's confusing when I say it, but message me, I will tell you that general trick that I follow. And once you start looking at stories that way, you'll find really inspiring stories all around you. And then you read a lot, like read as much as possible, read journals, newspapers, books, and you'll find these stories everywhere. And anything that's happening around you and you want to tell that story, you just go for it and film it. And I know you're already a filmmaker, so you can just go grab that opportunity whenever you see a story that clicks. Okay, many of us want to be a part of environment or wildlife conservation programs initiatives, but do not know how to go about it. Could you share some pointers? Okay, I can tell you from my experience, I started working with NGOs first when I wasn't even a wildlife filmmaker. So I worked with Wildlife Trust of India in New Delhi, Noida at that time. And I just told them that I'm really interested in wildlife filmmaking. I don't know much about it, but I want to make wildlife films. So they put me in their communications department and I used to make these small videos from their stock footage for them. So like these 1 minute awareness videos or just help them with the skills that I have. And this way, when you're starting out, you have to be as helpful as possible. You just start approaching NGOs, tell them you want to help. And that is the way to start building a network. And whatever skills you have, whatever your strengths are, you can use those to help these grassroots organizations working at the grassroots and start just helping them with their goals. There are so many online campaigns going on right now. So whatever your strength is, you volunteer for that. So that is how you just build a network. And apart from that, attend film festivals if you're into filmmaking, or like just places like these where like-minded people meet. And that's how, like right now what just happened, ma'am is connecting me to her friend. So just that is how networking happens. You just meet like-minded people and magic happens.
Gunjan, there was a query by Sudhanshu Verma, which you seem to have skipped. He has three questions, basically.
Sorry. Okay, I found it. Sorry, I think I scrolled past it. Sudhanshu says, as a vegan, I'm touched and feeling great that you're doing this amazing work for other species. Have you worked with something other than rare species? For example, in India, dairy is a big reason for cow slaughter and cruelty. So I haven't worked on cows in general right now, but I've worked with general like urban species like bats, which are not like they're not endangered. They're Schedule 4 right now in India, but they're often considered as pests, and they're not given the importance that they deserve. So I've done that. But you can make, like, whatever you're passionate about, you can tell that story. So it's good. I don't know. What do you do, Sudhanshu? Maybe if you feel so strongly about it, you can, you know, tell a story that you're concerned about. And you're right, dairy is a big reason for cow slaughter and cruelty, but there's not a lot of awareness. I know that some people are still very have quite cruelty free methods. Like if you look at traditional villages in India, they're not really torturing their cows to for their small businesses, but a majority of the industry is like that. So definitely that you can bring out the contrast that is happening without harming the local the actual local dairy farmers in villages.
We had a huge lot of trees that were cut in Bhopal and by the city to create a nonsense bridge that we didn't need and did not help us. But some person, I don't want to say this in my usual way, but what I usually say is some neta had to send his kid to Australia to study. So a contractor had to be given this work. And it's the three bridges have been made in Bhopal, which are nonsense. And they have created problems. But because of that, there was a huge, huge population of bats which were displaced. They were in these very, very large trees. And that road that they cut them from actually was a road that you'd see in some rural area, because Bhopal is almost rural. You drive for 10 minutes and you'll be in La La Land. So yeah. they were a canopy of trees. They were that close. And then they cut them down, and then these bats became homeless. And I'm not very much into what is happening in Wuhan and what happened in the market there and what happened. I don't know all that. But I do know that displacing the bats was a bad idea.
Yeah, this is why, like, in general, if you just put the pandemic aside, in general, this is how diseases spread. Because, like, wildlife and humans, if we cross that boundary, bats especially are carriers of a lot of zoonotic diseases because their immune system is a lot better than ours. So even without getting affected, they can carry a lot of diseases, but without harming anyone. So if they're there in their own space and we are here, there is absolutely no harm to us from them. But with incidents like this, when they're displaced,
the tree also thrives because of them.
That's exactly. They're like dispersals. Yeah.
It's always symbiotic. Any species that lives anywhere, whether it's a cattle egret with a cattle or it is one thing with the other, this symbiotic nature that we as human beings have ignored.
Yeah. Like fruit bats are dispersers of seeds and fruits, and insectivores control the insect population. So they're actually so helpful, but...
Gunjan, Sudhanshu has two more queries. Like,
yes, one is,
what's the process of getting started into research of wildlife documentary filmmaking, and how do you bring
guys with locals and officials? Okay, so to answer your second question, the process of starting into research, you depends on what degree you have. But even if you don't, if you can join hands with any filmmaker and tell them that you want to help them with research. For example, in a project that I just did, I worked with a PhD person pursuing PhD in wildlife I think wildlife science, and another person who was in her first year zoology, and I got both of them together to work on research for my film. So they would like give me all the science backing and do extensive research for my programs, because every script that is there in our films, it needs to have at least 2 scientific verified sources, because we are putting information out in the public domain, so it has to be absolutely verified. So we often work with researchers. So if you want to start out, I think the first step would be to get in touch with filmmakers, or if you're researching for your own film, then you just read as many research papers as they are on that particular subject of your film. And I think we are now used to reading like hundreds of research papers and skimming through the important pointers. You have to be able to tell what nugget of information will seem interesting in your script in the end. And how do I break ice with locals and officials? There's no really any need of ice breaking. I mean, when we film in forests, I take forest department permission, so we already have all the necessary permits. As far as getting authentic interviews and actually getting to know them is concerned, it takes time. You have to spend time with them. In Menuka's case for Red Panda Network, since we couldn't even speak the same language, I did not take her interview at all on the first day. I put the camera aside. I was getting very rehearsed answers that, yes, I'm very happy, yes, we love red pandas, but that's not what you want. So you just put the camera aside, you spend time with them, you get to know them. I trekked with her, I spoke to her about red pandas, and eventually by the 5th day, she was comfortable and she could open up to me about her personal struggles, her life as a female forest guard. Breaking ice, I think in this field, is just about being patient and just being sincere to give them a voice to tell their real stories and not feed answers. I think that is the only way to let locals know that you care, and actually just be sincere about it. There is no other way to break ice. And with officials also, I've never really faced any problems as such. You just need to, I think once they get to know that you are who you say you are and you want to actually help tell this conservation story, then they don't really create any problems. So there's no ice breaking that's needed. Hope that answers your questions. I'm sorry I skipped you. Just my cursor would have just went fast.
Yes, Sudhanshu says, thank you so much for answering. It's amazing to know all this in detail. Niharika has a specific question related to filmmaking.
Mm-hmm. I'm more interested in landscape and nature filmmaking rather than wildlife filmmaking. For that, could you tell me how is the course in documentary filmmaking at Aprosfield University? Okay, I haven't heard of this course, Niharika, but I can look at it once for you. If you find me, either email me or find me on Instagram and send me like the course module, I will look at it for you. I think one basic thing that you'll have to watch out for is that it's more practical based and not just theoretical, because if you want to be a filmmaker, you have to see how much access they're giving you to equipment, how much practical exposure are they giving you, how are they tied with internships, all of that. So I can go over it once for you if you just send me the link of this university and their course module. Okay. Someone's spoken about Seaspiracy. So I haven't seen Seaspiracy, but what I've heard about it is that it's a great documentary, but it does not look at the local point of view from the eyes of the fishermen. So our local fishermen are quite sustainable in their practices, but I think it ignores that point of view and completely disregards the whole industry as a blanket thing. So I think That is what I've read about it, but I haven't seen the film yet. I have to watch it.
Gunjan, I have something to share about the film.
I can't see.
I'm Sudhanshu Desai. Sorry, I...
Your video is
let off. Let me switch on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
So good to see you, and really loved how you explained all the things. I'm myself a filmmaker and a photographer, and I specialize into documenting weddings.
Okay.
And I have done a docage workshop into becoming a documentary filmmaker myself. So I was watching Seaspiracy, and true that they did not touch upon the part how locals are involved into that. But I think what they really showcased was, I think somebody's mic is on. Can you please turn off the mic? Yeah. So I think what they touched upon was how whales are being hunted, and different species of fishes are being hunted in a mass in Thailand and other places in India, where it actually some of the places say they are banned. And they also touched upon few major organizations who promises that they don't harm animals or whales in the process of making their products. So they documented and kind of shown that what they promise is false, and there is also a dark side behind the laborers working and for catching the fishes. I mean, the kind of slavery which is happening, like people being pushed to death and murder on the ship if they object to not work on the sea and the ship. So they literally pushed them on, like, out of the sea. There were people showing that they were forced to be on the ship and hunt whales and do all this cruelty. So I'm sure I think you will have a better understanding of the documentary once you watch it. And I totally get that, there is always a local side to it. Like, locals thrive on few practices. It's been done since ages, so we cannot object on that, but you should definitely watch it.
Gunjan, you are on mute.
Sorry. Yeah. I'll definitely watch it. And on slavery, related to what you were saying, there's another really good film called Ghost Fleet, which you can check out. That also covers that whole spectrum really well.
And there is another query for you. Where did you study filmmaking?
Okay. I studied it. So I did my bachelor's in Symbiosis Institute of Media and Communication in Pune. But that was purely focused on audiovisual communication, so just filmmaking. And while I was doing that, I did 6 internships with different organizations where I used to work with animals or work with wildlife NGOs and use my filmmaking skills to sort of turn it into wildlife filmmaking. But the course wasn't really wildlife filmmaking specific. But then after that, I worked for a bit, and like Sudhanshu, I also shot a lot of weddings. I did commercial stuff. I did worked on ads, music videos, comedy sketches. But then later, eventually, I did my master's in wildlife filmmaking. This was an MA in wildlife filmmaking course in Bristol, which is like the hub of wildlife filmmaking in the world. More than like 40% wildlife films are made in Bristol. It was in University of West of England, and this was a course in partnership with the BBC Natural History Unit. So that was really helpful for me to sort of get into wildlife storytelling specifically. And since then, I've been focused only on wildlife filmmaking, and it hasn't been that difficult to pursue this full time, actually.
Thanks, Gunjan. Adya is currently a student of SCMC Pune.
Yeah, it was SIMC back when I did it, but it's changed to SCMC now. So yay.
Yay. So glad to hear that.
Vyas Rajshekhar, you wanted to ask something?
Yeah, a couple of things. Say hi. It's like, Gunjan, it's a beautiful work, and then it's nice to see the conservation efforts you're making, and it is having an impact on the, the particular conservation part. I have a couple of questions. One is, what are the support systems you get, or after this what is the conservation steps being taken by the government or the local bodies around that red panda thing? I mean, is there any, that's one. Second, in terms of food habits, I didn't see any bamboo rich place. You see normal tree. So, I mean, is it very different from white panda? Because I spent some time in Chengdu, is the largest white panda conservation. Though it is not a cap, it's not a wild one, but they made it beautifully as a captive one. In fact, there are a lot of ideas they did, which promotes the world's, I would say, the capital of panda. They have a panda diplomacy where they loan panda animals to various countries, various zoos. You know, it's amazingly brilliant ideas. You know, you can go to this particular place and take 3 days or 5 days. You can, as a normal volunteer, you can spend time with panda. You can clean them, you can feed them, you can do, you know, all these things you can do. It's some money, the money goes for the contribution. So a lot of children, a lot of people go there and camp in this particular site and do that kind of a thing. So amazing promotion to, you know about white panda. So red panda, though I saw some of them in that particular place, but it's not known widely that red panda do exist. It's such a beautiful animal. We don't have it to, you know, see it so well. We know only, honestly, I've not seen anything so far. So what are the efforts being made by the government of Nepal, or is it any possibility of other countries getting involved, or where the habitat is suitable for that to, you know, kind of recreate them, or, you know, is there anything you know of that?
Yeah, so red pandas are actually found in India also along the Himalayan belt, and in Nepal, most of the red panda habitat lies outside the protected areas. So local communities working for their conservation, that's where their role comes in, because they've been traditionally in charge of their own forest. They're called community forests there, and they take care of their own patch of forest, not because someone asked them to, but because they have to. I mean, it is their way of life to protect the animals and the forest there. So that has been helping. So Red Panda Network there has been working with the local communities. And since the film came out, government has been helping with a lot of anti-poaching initiatives. And Red Panda Network itself, they have expanded their area where they're working, and they're working on habitat restoration, anti-poaching, and they have employed even more these local community members to work with them in these efforts. So that's happening. They've been trying, and their headquarters is in the United States. They've been trying to expand to other areas as well, and there they work with a lot of zoos for breeding programs, and they release red pandas into the wild. They've also recently collared a lot of red pandas to study their movements and how their habitat, their patterns, and what fragmentation is doing to their behavior. So all of that is happening. In India, WWF works with red pandas along in Northeast India. I've been to Arunachal, their site in Arunachal Pradesh, and they too work with the local communities there. The Buddhist Monpas there are working to protect the red pandas in their region. So that way, I think, for red pandas, they are totally dependent on the local communities, and the fact that they feel that it is their pride to protect red pandas. And coming to your second question, bamboo, yes, this area, the forest was totally dominated by bamboo. Okay. That is, that consists of a majority of the diet for red pandas as well. Okay. I think maybe the clips that you saw, that was just the trekking bit and not the core red panda habitat. Okay. But where the red pandas are found, that is predominantly bamboo. And that is the reason that they're so rare, because they prefer pure bamboo forests, and they need this really pure forest, which is why they're an indicator species. So wherever red pandas are found, which means that that habitat is very pristine. Okay. So that
is this tribal community economy is dependent on bamboo?
Sorry, your voice was breaking. Could you repeat?
Sorry,
that?
I said, is the tribal community involved in this? Their economy is based on bamboo?
Not in Nepal. Nepal, these were earlier poachers who've been transformed to become forest guardians, because they are the ones with traditional knowledge of where the animals are. So now they've shifted their livelihood to make them to indulge in ecotourism. So they help in panda tracking, essentially what they were doing earlier, but instead of killing the panda, now they're helping tourists look at pandas.
That's interesting, because normally when you have something attached to your livelihood and you started protecting that in around that. So anything connected to bamboo, you know, you want to get the money. So
maybe it is there in Arunachal Pradesh. I did see.
That's what I asked. Arunachal, they had this, every economy is based on bamboo. So everything connected to conservative.
Nepal, I think I was in a very remote area where the people only did this. But maybe like in bigger villages, they depend on bamboo.
Okay, that's cool. That's nice to know. Yeah, maybe one day we'd like to see a situation like Chengdu, where we can promote in a much more larger way, and everyone knows about Red Panda and we preserve it. So nice. Definitely. Brilliant work. Keep it up and all the best to you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Vyaj Rajshekhar. Now, Jyoti wants to know, Gunjan, do you use a drone for filming? How much does it cost, and are there any specific permits required for their use?
So I do use a drone for filming sometimes. For the first film, the Red Panda film, I did not use it simply because I couldn't afford it at that time. I was a student. For the latest project, I did take a drone with me. How much it cost? I mean, there are different types of drones. It depends on which one you want. It can cost from a Mavic Pro 2 is a really good drone, small, tiny drone that you can take, and it doesn't cost a lot. So that's a good one that you can try out if you're just starting out. And specific permits is very dicey in India with drone. You just have to be ethical, because a lot of drone filmmakers disturb wildlife. And as long as you're ethical and maintain your distance, it's fine. As far as national parks and wildlife sanctuaries are concerned, you cannot fly inside a national park or wildlife sanctuary. And outside protected areas, you can fly, but you have to be careful of how far you're flying from an endangered animal or just animals in general. You just have to be respectful. You cannot just... there was this video floating around a few months back where a brown bear was... Like a drone was really close to a brown bear on a in the Himalayas somewhere, and the bear actually was getting very stressed out, and the cub was fell into the mountain, and he was trying to rescue the cub. So basically, don't harass wildlife if you're using drones. Use it to show the beautiful expanse of the wild habitats. That's fine, but. Sorry, I just again went into ethics when that was not your question. I get very carried away, guys. I'm sorry. But I did answer your permits question, so that's why.
Gunjan, I think that's every filmmaker's job to do these days. Because more and more gear is just coming out, and you know, even I get these queries at which drone to buy, how to buy, where to fly. And now the DGC has new guidelines.
Yeah,
and in fact, a few months back, I sold my drone because I felt I was being very constrained about these guidelines. And nowadays, even when you fly in open or at resorts, people object.
Yeah, so I think the rule is that if it's a private property, you have the permission of the owner, landowner. If it's public, you have to have the permission of the local police. But I haven't. Every place has their own rules, so you have to read about where you're flying, I think. Am I right, Sudhanshu? I haven't really checked up on the rules.
Absolutely. I mean, I think in your work, things are pretty much sorted, because, you know, you directly get in touch with government officials. And over there is no, in all the planning happens in the first place. But in my case, I was shooting weddings, so it was always dicey that whether they allow it or not.
Thanks, Sudhanshu. Dheeraj Mali has a question, and I think that's the last question we will take in this session. Yes, Dheeraj, please unmute yourself and you can ask your query.
Hi, good evening, everyone.
Hello, Dheeraj.
Can I speak in Hindi, because my English is not.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
So, main वैसे एक wildlife photographer हूँ, और अभी filming में मुझे career बनाना है, तो कैसे शुरुआत की जाए? जैसे मैंने अभी पिछले एक साल तक एक leopard पर काम किया है, तो उसकी भी script वगैरह पूरी कहानी लिख कर रखी हुई है, और data भी पड़ा है मेरे पास, लेकिन इसको editing table तक पहुँचाना और किस प्लेटफॉर्म पर उसको मतलब ले जा सकता हूँ मैं, किस तरीके से उसको मतलब ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों तक पहुंचा सकता हूँ, तो उसके बारे में बताइए कुछ।
तो धीरज, आपको दो तीन चीजें पहले मतलब सोचनी पड़ेगी, देखनी पड़ेगी कि वो जो फोटोग्राफी से फिल्म मेकिंग का जो वो है, क्या वो आप खुद शूट कर सकते हो कि आपको किसी और की हेल्प लेनी है शूट करने के लिए?
नहीं, काफी कुछ तो शूट कर लिया, जैसे एडिशनल वीडियोस लगते हैं ना, तो वो जैसे वो मेरे पास जैसे नहीं रहेंगे तो वो कैसे मैं उसमें ले सकता हूँ?
अच्छा,
जैसे ड्रोन से हो गए, वहां के जंगल का हो गया, डिस्क्रिप्शन दे दिया इस तरीके से।
तो ये सब हम लोग क्या करते हैं, यूजुअली कोलैबोरेशंस करते हैं जब स्टार्ट कर रहे होते हैं। तो जो भी आपको लगता है आपके पास नहीं है, आप अपनी एक छोटी सी टीम बनाओ। जैसे अगर आपको लगता है आपको ड्रोन फुटेज चाहिए, तो आपके एरिया में अगर कोई फिल्म मेकर्स आए हैं, या फिर आपको पता है कि कोई आपके पास रहता है, कोई दोस्त है जो आके दो चार ड्रोन शॉट्स ले सकते हैं आपके हिसाब से, अगर आउटसाइड प्रोटेक्टेड एरिया ऑब्वियसली, तो आप ऐसे अपना टीम बना लो एंड उनके साथ कोलैबोरेट करके अपने स्क्रिप्ट के हिसाब से फिनिश करके कर सकते हो। फिर एक एडिटर को साथ में ले लो जो आपकी स्टोरी के हिसाब से उसको थोड़ा थोड़ा एडिट कर सके। एंड अगर अभी बजट नहीं है तो आप ऐसा भी कर सकते हो कि थोड़ा सा एक छोटा सा टीजर पहले बनाओ या शॉर्ट फिल्म बनाओ। लोग क्या करते हैं, डायरेक्टली उनको लंबा फिल्म बनाने की फर्स्ट फिल्म कोशिश करते हैं। आप शॉर्ट से स्टार्ट करो, शॉर्ट फिल्म आप उसको, फिर शॉर्ट फिल्म जब आपकी अच्छी सक्सेसफुल हो जाएगी, आप उसको अपने विजिटिंग कार्ड की तरह यूज करो कि मैं यहाँ पे रहता हूँ एंड मैं इतने सालों से मैं एक्सपर्ट हूँ स्पीशीज में, मुझे अब लंबी फिल्म बनानी है। तो आप छोटा सा स्टार्ट करके फिर बड़े पे जा सकते हो। तो आप अपनी एक टीम बना के स्टार्ट करो। आपने बोला कि अगर आप ऑलरेडी फिल्म कर रहे हो, किया है आपने बहुत कुछ स्टोरी के हिसाब से, तो आप उसको स्टार्ट पुटिंग इट टुगेदर। और अगर टीम नहीं मिल रही है, अभी ऑब्वियसली कोविड है, नहीं हो रहा है कोई, बहुत सारे रिमोटली काम कर रहे हैं, रिमोटली आप कोशिश करो कि हो सकता है कोई एक एडिटर ढूंढ रहा हो कि वाइल्ड लाइफ में इंटरेस्ट है लेकिन फुटेज नहीं है, तो ऐसा फोरम्स पे जाके या फिल्म फेस्टिवल्स पे जाके लोगों से जितना बात करोगे, आपको उतना अपने टाइप के लोग मिलेंगे जो आपके जैसा सोचते हैं, आपके जैसा काम ढूंढ रहे हैं। तो वैसा छोटा सा टीम बना के आप अपना ये पूरा कर सकते हो। और कुछ भी हेल्प चाहिए हो तो आई एम श्योर जो आप ऑलरेडी इतने फिल्म मेकर्स को फॉलो करते हो, मेरे से बात करते रहते हो, विल बी हैप्पी टू टेक अ लुक आपके रशेस पे, आपने जैसे अगर रफ कट बनाया हो कि ये सही डायरेक्शन में जा रहा है कि नहीं जा रहा, कुछ भी छोटे मोटे चेंजेस हो, तो एवरीवन विल हैप्पीली हेल्प यू।
बिल्कुल, थैंक यू वेरी मच,
ऑल द बेस्ट।
थैंक्स धीरज, थैंक्स गुंजन फॉर पेशेंटली आंसरिंग ऑल द क्वेश्चंस। एंड आई विल नाउ रिक्वेस्ट सुधांशु वर्मा, हु विल बी द गेस्ट फॉर आवर नेक्स्ट सेशन, टू गिव अ ब्रीफ इंट्रो अबाउट व्हाट द सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी अबाउट। And meanwhile, Gunjan, if you can type some of the links in the chat box for the movies that you covered in your presentation, it will be great because we would like to watch those movies in full.
Sure. I'll do that. Thank you so much for having me. I kept half an hour for question answers, wo bhi kam pad gaye, but that's nice. That always means that everyone's interested. So that's nice. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Gunjan. Yes, Sudhanshu, over to you.
Hi, guys. Thank you, Gunjan, for an amazing session. The filmmaker in me is now getting fired up again. hi, guys. I am an adventure cyclist. And my topic for the session is going to be a bicycle, which I also call my moving home. And the what I have discovered on my bicycle is truly the non-competitive side of cycling, and it kept me going, and it kept me, making me experience things while I was on these journeys, like Jaipur to Kanyakumari solo, 42 days. And several other journeys I did in Ladakh. So on my session, we'll be discussing about how I got into cycle touring, and how as a kid I was, exploring my the craziness of, doing cycling for every day for 35 to 40 kilometers. So I'm looking forward to the session, Vivek, and you know, I'll be very happy to share about this wonderful community which is slowly building up in India. It's called Bikepacking Community, and I would just quickly give a small definition about bikepacking. It's basically you take your bike where people hike. So we'll be talking about more of such amazing stories and my experience on the road. Hi guys, was I audible or is it? Because I think
looks like Vivek's connectivity is problematic. Yeah, I think he got disconnected, and I'll step in. Thank you, Sudhanshu, and looking forward to meeting you next week. The registration link is getting ready, so we'll share the link to all our ex-participants and in our group also, maybe later today. So looking forward to seeing you all Saturday. Vivek, you are back anyway. So I was giving the closing remarks. Anyway, you are here.
Yeah, thanks Murugraj. Suddenly the connection got cut. So I would like to thank Gunjan once again for taking out time from a busy schedule, and a big thanks to all the participants who were part of such a enriching and session. And Gunjan has shared some links in the chat box. I can see the Red Panda Network link. Maybe she would have shared the other links while I got disconnected. So Murugraj, I would request you to pass on those to me. So thanks, Gunjan, before we sign off, just wanted to confirm that we have shared all the links. Yeah.
Not yet. I'm still like typing. Give me 2 minutes. Sorry.
Oh, okay, no problem. We haven't heard from Devanand Paul. Maybe we will talk to him while you type the last link. You mentioned 7. Yes, Mr. Paul. Today was actually the first session where the presentation was half an hour and the question and answers was 1 hour, which I think says a lot about the presentation and the speaker and the quality of the participants, the work that all of us are doing and the speaker is doing. And everyone stayed till the end, and like we had a good attendance today, good almost 25-26 participants were there, and I hope everyone enjoyed the session. Sayantani Ghosh, she is from Pune, and Gunjan is also in Pune. So Sayantani had a question about like, how can people who want to get into conservation, how can they start? So I think she can get connected with Gunjan, and then Gunjan can guide her. And maybe even with Adya, who is from the same college from which Gunjan did her education.
We need Gunjan's contact, her own contact, her email address.
Yeah.
Yes, I think she had.
Put it in the chat.
Yes,
it's here again, and like for the younger ones who are on Instagram, I am @JungleBook.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Gunjan, for all the links.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Yeah, have a nice day. All the best for your future work.
You too.